Hello and good afternoon. It is a pleasure to welcome today Professor Yuri Matyasevich from the Steklov Institute of Mathematics from St. Petersburg, Russia. So we are lucky that he is here because he gave a talk at the conference in computational discovery at University of Western Ontario. And since that is not so far away, we took advantage of this situation to ask him to give a talk here as well. Professor Matyasevich, of course, really doesn't need an introduction because we all know him in mathematics and computer science alike, from senior to freshman students, as having solved in the negative Hilbert stem problem on the solvability of Diophantine equations. But from my perspective, I work in theoretical computer science and I'm editor of theoretical computer science. I'm proud to say that he has at least three papers published in theoretical computer science with topics ranging from solving word equations, modulo partial commutations with Volker Dieter and Anna Muskol, to decision problems for semi-2n systems with a few rules, and to post-correspondent problems for lethal monotonic languages with Vesa Halava and Jarkko Kari. Today he's going to talk to us about computer experiments for approximating Riemann zeta functions by finite Dirichlet series, and it's my pleasure to introduce, without further ado, Professor Yuri Matyasevich.
Thank you. I am very glad to give this talk today because I found that this is a very proper place to speak. Actually, I gave a lot of talks on this subject for purely mathematical audience, and each time I had to start by asking an excuse. Sorry, in my today's talk, there will be no new theorems, there will be no proofs at all. All what I will be speaking about will be just computations, and their interpretations. But now we have a joint colloquium with computational mathematics, so I can justify my work that it relies entirely on computations and rather heavy computations. But before I start speaking about what I was doing, I believe I need to make some short introduction into this area because I cannot expect that everyone is familiar with it. I will start with the time of Euler. He spent half of his life in St. Petersburg, where I was born and live now. And he began to consider such a series, which is called Dirichlet series. It's similar to Taylor series, but the natural numbers and the variables change their positions. And Euler gave another definition of this series in the form of such product. At first it looks strange, but it is not, in fact, difficult to prove it. It suffices to notice that what we have here is just the sum of this infinite geometrical progression. If you remove braces here, we would just obtain all possible products of primes in all possible powers. And so, in fact, Euler identity is just the fundamental theorem of arithmetic, stating that each natural number has an almost unique representation as product of powers of prime numbers. This is a very simple observation, but it turned out to be a very powerful tool for studying prime numbers because on the one side, we have product over primes only, but on the other side, we have, so to say, homogeneous sum over all natural numbers. And Euler immediately made application of this identity. He gave a new proof of the infinitude of prime numbers. You know the famous, very elegant proof given by Euclid, but I believe that the proof given by Euler is as elegant and as beautiful as Euclid's proof. And Euler's proof can be stated just in one phrase. If the number of primes would be finite, then the divergent harmonic series would have finite value. So So when S is equal to 1, here we have the harmonic series which diverge, and here we have a product, and it would be just a finite number if there would be only finitely many prime numbers. So this series is usually noted by the Greek letter zeta, and it is called Riemann's zeta function. Why Riemann's and not Euler's? Euler considered this function only for real values of S, and Riemann began to consider it for the complex variable, and he introduced this today traditional notation with real part equal to sigma and imaginary part equal to t. And this series converges in a semi-plane where the real part of S is greater than 1, but it can be analytically continued to the whole complex plane except the point S equal to 1, which is the only pole of the zeta function. And already Euler indicated that negative even integers are the rows of zeta function. And Riemann proved that there are no other real zeros. And these zeros are today called trivial zeros of the zeta function. And Riemann began to study other non-trivial complex zeros of the same function. And he found a very nice formula expressing the function pi of x, the number of primes below this number x. Already Gauss noticed that pi of x is very well approximated by this integral, but Gauss had no proof. It was just a result of his observations on the tables of primes. And this function grows approximately as x divided by log of x. And Riemann gave an explicit formula for pi of x, with the main term being just this integral. This is the second term, which is almost square root of this one, plus this sum taken over all zeros of this zeta function. But today it is more usual and more convenient to work not with the function pi of x, but with the function psi of x, which was introduced by Russian mathematician Chebyshov. This function can be defined in the following way. We make summation up to x for all numbers q, which are powers of a prime number p, and each time we add log of this p. We can compare this definition with the definition of pi of x. It can be defined as summation up to x of all primes below x, and each time we sum ones. So there are two differences. Here we sum ones are 1, and here they are log of p, and here summation is about larger set of numbers. This definition might look unnatural, but we can define the same function in a different way. It's just the logarithm of least common multiple of all integers not greater than x. So it is easy to understand that log is a function which grows very slowly. So we should expect that psi of x should be approximately equal to pi of x multiplied by log of x. Since we know that pi of x is approximately x divided by log of x, we should expect that psi of x should be approximately equal to x. Of course, psi of x is a step function, and here just is its plot. It jumps at 2 prime number, at 3 prime number, at 4 power of prime number 2, at 5, no jump at 6, a jump at 7, and so on. So this was Riemann's formula, and von Mankell found a corresponding formula for the function psi. It looks rather similar. Again, we have summation over all zeros of zeta function, but now we have a simpler summons and a simpler main term. I would like just to show you how this theorem works, so to say. Let us consider this expression when we restrict the size of zeros by 50 in absolute value. Of course, we wouldn't obtain psi exactly. We would obtain some blue continuous function, but it looks approximately like the step function psi of x. We can increase the number of used zeros to 200, and we will see that approximation is much better. And if we take 400, it will be even better. I like to give another interpretation of von Mangold theorem. It is an equality, and usually we understand equality in the following way. We have left-hand side, right-hand side with some parameter. We can substitute any value for the parameter, calculate both sides, and they turn out to be equal. But imagine that we do not know prime numbers at all, even the definition. But we have a computer. We can calculate zeros of zeta function. And we could start calculating such sums and plot them. We would notice that these sums behave like almost step functions. And the jumps are always at integers. And these are very interesting integers. They are exactly primes and prime numbers. In this way, I say that we could discover prime numbers from zeros of the zeta function. And we could do it even in two ways. Instead of places where we have jumps, we can look at the sizes of jumps. And sizes of jumps are always logarithms of some integers, and these integers are exactly prime numbers. In other words, I could say that zeros of the zeta function encodes prime numbers and even in two ways. And now I can say in two words what I am to present to you. I will describe a yet another way in which zeros of zeta function can be used for defining and discovering prime numbers. So for number theory, it is of interest how well is this approximation of psi of x by x. And from this formula, you can see that the answer depends on the real parts of zeros of the zeta function. And the famous Riemann hypothesis predicts that, in fact, all the non-real zeros of the zeta function lie on so-called critical line, where the real part of S is equal to 1/2. Here. Riemann himself was able to prove only a weak statement that all the zeros lie in the side so-called critical strip between 0 and 1, non-strictly. And the Riemann hypothesis implies that this is indeed a very good approximation with the error of order of square root of x. Or in terms of the psi function, it gives approximation of the order of square of x with another log factor. And these are indeed equivalent formulations. If you prove any of these two formulas, you will prove that all zeros do lie on the critical line. The Riemann hypothesis is very important for number theory. There is a lot of theorems which were proved only on the assumption of the Riemann hypothesis. But it is also of interest for computer science. For example, nowadays we have a polynomial algorithm for determining primality. But if we believe in the so-called extended Riemann hypothesis, then we would get even better polynomial time algorithm for testing primality. Now I can pass to my own research. So we have this infinite series, and we would like to study it via finite Dirichlet series. Of course, we could just cut it after some number of summons, but because the series does not converge inside the critical strip, which is for interest of us, the zeros of this finite sum do not contain much information about the zeros of the real zeta function. My idea was a bit different. Let us try to consider other finite Dirichlet series with some numerical coefficients here. The question is how to select these coefficients. What would we would like to have from this capital delta function? We would like it to be somehow similar to the genuine zeta function. Similar in what sense? Of course, we would like it to have similar zeros. And that was the starting point for my definition. Let us just demand that this finite sum should have n minus 1 common zeros with this infinite sum. Why n minus 1? Because here we have n parameters, but of course we can always multiply by any number, so we can just make a normalization by demanding that the first coefficient should be equal to 1. The rest is n minus 1 free parameters. We can give a more formal definition. We have our zeta series. It has zeros which are symmetrical. It's clear to see that if some number is zero, then its conjugate is also zero. If we believe in the Riemann hypothesis, we can write these zeros as 1/2 plus something purely imaginary. If we believe that they are simple, we can order them by increasing value of the imaginary part. And so I just demand that my finite series should vanish at m pairs of conjugate zeros. I will always take for n an odd number, 2m plus 1, and I will just demand that it should vanish exactly at this initial m zeros. So I change the traditional way of things. Typically, we start from a function and ask what are its zeros. And here I say I want these zeros, and I want to see what will be the properties of this function. We can give more explicit definition of this series. Just consider such determinant. Rows correspond to natural numbers 1, 2, n, capital N. And columns correspond to zeros, the first zero and its conjugate, next zeros and m zero and m its conjugate. But in the last column, we have the free variable s. And clearly, if s is equal to one of these zeros used here, then we would have two equal columns, and the determinant would vanish. But if we expand the determinant according to the last column, we would obtain what we needed, a finite Dirichlet series. It's not exactly what we needed, because we wanted the first coefficient to be equal to 1. So we need just to make normalization to divide by the first coefficient. And so we can define our coefficients deltas in this way. We can go further and give quite explicit expressions for these deltas. We need just delete the last column in the previous determinant and to delete nth row to define this number tilde delta capital NN. Then we make normalization and consider our finite Dirichlet series. And my goal is to convince you that these lowercase deltas numbers are very, very interesting numbers. And we can consider equations of two kinds. What are the properties of this capital delta function as a function of S? And what are the properties of lowercase deltas by themselves? So I was just curious to see if something interesting could be here. I had a computer at my disposal, and it was quite easy to make initial computations. Here is an example. Let us take m equal to 8, n to 17. And here is the plot of these coefficients, these numbers. We see that they are originally almost ones, but then they gradually decay. It was quite a nice picture. Visualization is a very good thing, but still we need to use some symbolic notation. And I introduce such a notation, double harpoon. It connects two Dirichlet series. It is a relation of similarity, but it is a very weak relation of similarity. It says that several initial coefficients of two Dirichlet series are approximately equal. The weakness is due to two things. We speak only about some initial fragments, and we speak about only approximate equality of the coefficients. But you will see later that even such weak relationship of similarity suggests often very interesting numerical equalities. So these were the coefficients. And here you will see the plot of the function zeta along the critical line and our function capital delta. We see a very good coincidence of both real and imaginary paths. Of course, the function passes through the 8 zeros which were used in the construction. At the beginning, the coincidence is not good. At the end also. But in between zeros, they coincide, and you can distinguish red and blue. You see just violet. But what is interesting, the coincidence continues at some distance after the last used zero. This capital delta vanishes close to the zeros of the zeta function. And here are just numerical examples. Capital delta vanishes near the ninth zero. It has three common decimal digits. For the next zero, it has two decimal digits. For the next, also two, and so on. OK, it was interesting. I continued computations. Here is an example with m equal to 50. And now we have much better number of common digits. This capital delta vanishes near the 51st zero, and it has 15 common decimal digits, here 14, 17, and so on. If you take even better, greater value of m, you would get even more common digits. Here we have more than 1,000 common digits. And even we go very far from the zeros used here, we still have plenty of common digits in the zeros. So I express it in the following words. Initial non-trivial zeros of a zeta function somehow know about certain amount about subsequent non-trivial zeros not used in the construction of our delta determinants. Okay, this was about non-trivial zeros, but we know that zeta function has trivial zeros. How our delta function behaves at trivial zeros? Surprisingly, it vanishes near numbers minus 2, minus 4, minus 6, and so on. We have, again, a lot of correct decimal digits for these zeros. So I could say that zeta zeros are very, very knowledgeable. They know about subsequent non-trivial zeros. And also, they know about trivial zeros. that weren't used at all in the construction of our capital delta function. So is it surprising or not? Let us consider a more familiar situation when we have a Taylor series, and we will try to do the same. Suppose that our Taylor series is a good function, and it has a product expansion, and we just want to consider a polynomial having a number of common zeros with this function. We just take this finite product. Question, does this finite product know anything about subsequent zeros? Certainly not. These zeros cannot know anything about other zeros because these other zeros can be arbitrary. And so the fact that zeros of zeta function knows about subsequent zeros should be due through the fact that the function is defined by a Dirichlet series. It is known that the property to be defined by Dirichlet series is a very strong property. It imposes many properties on the function itself. So you already saw this picture, very nice picture. Now I will show you the case when capital N is equal to 101. And the picture is rather different. When I saw it for the first time, I believed that there is a mistake in my program. How is it possible that originally it was such a nice one sentence in decaying, and now we have such a strange picture? But in fact, this is more typical behavior. For a big value of capital N, this picture is more standard. And so how can we express it symbolically? We should say that now our delta function, finite Dirichlet series, looks like this alternating series with the coefficients alternating between 1 and minus 1. And this sum is very well known. It's easy to verify that it's just this product. We need to multiply zeta function by this extra factor. And this function is known as eta function. So it's quite natural to make a conjecture that if we fix lowercase n and allow capital N to go to infinity, then the coefficients would approach minus 1 to the power n plus 1. And what does it mean in terms of our initial goals? We defined this function as a function vanishing at these zeros. But in fact, this eta function vanishes at the same zeros as well, because it's just a product of zeta function by this extra factor. So by dealing with just non-trivial zeros, we cannot distinguish zeta function and eta function. And so the question is only why capital delta behaves like eta function and not like zeta function. Again, we can get an explanation by comparison with meromorphic function. Suppose now that our f is the ratio of two products. We begin to consider finite polynomials. Would the coefficients of these polynomials approach these coefficients? Of course not. These coefficients would approach the coefficients of the expansion of only numerator of this fraction, because we used just zeros and did not use poles at all. So we cannot expect these coefficients to approach these coefficients. In other words, we should say that our zeta function should be treated as the ratio of two entire functions, eta of s and this finite Dirichlet series. Interesting question, why exactly this series, but I would not dwell on it. But as soon as we have this extra function, extra factor, we got extra zeros. This extra factor vanishes when S is of such a form. The case k equal to 0 just cancels the power of zeta function, but other values of k add zeros to this eta function. And as by miracle, our capital delta vanishes near the zeros of this extra function as well. So I say that zeta zeros are very, very, very knowledgeable. Somehow they know about non-trivial zeros, trivial zeros, and also they know about the pole by vanishing at the factors, at the zeros of the factor that cancels the pole. So now I will come to second kind of properties. Of course, these numbers should be very interesting because they produce such a good approximations. And it's very natural to conjecture that they actually alternate. Would it be difficult or not to prove it? There is such a strange obstacle, possibly. Look at this picture. When capital N is 221, yes, originally they alternate between ones and minus ones, but before vanishing, they somehow grow up a little. Another example. Here, again, they start as plus and minus ones, but before vanishing, they change the sign and grow rather high. This is a bizarre behavior, and I have no explanation whether it's due to some properties of these capital N values or whether it is due to the corresponding zeta zero. I would like to show you many such pictures. So it's more or less the same, but every now and then there are some strange peaks. Okay, that's enough. So let us examine our lowercase deltas. What can we see from such a picture? Here we see almost straight lines. We cannot distinguish details here. So let us examine carefully what happens near one. To this end, I will subtract one here. So these differences will be very small for odd values of n. I will take the absolute value, take the logarithm, and here is the plot of these quantities. So we have a very clear structure. We see that points tend to lay on several levels. Let us try to understand how it happens. It's easy to understand that here at the top we have even values of lowercase n when the delta is minus 1, so this is minus 2 and this is just log of 2. Here we have points with step 6. Every point for n divisible by 3 but not divisible by 2. On the next level, we have points corresponding to the value of n, divisible by 5, but not divisible neither by 2 nor by 3. On the next level, we have numbers divisible by 7, but not divisible neither by 2, nor by 3, nor by 5. The same for 11, 13, 17. And so what are numbers here? Can you guess? Primes, what remains is a primes. And how would you call this picture? Sieve? Yes. I say that it is a sieve of Eratosthenes. So it was rather surprising. Eratosthenes was a human being. He invented a process for selecting primes among natural numbers. And here we used just a stupid computer. We forced it to calculate first zeta zeros, then to calculate the determinants, and then to make such a plot. And all of a sudden, we discovered prime numbers.
Sorry.
Hope it's survived. Does not work any longer. One battery went out, sorry. So here we have very big value of capital N, but I showed you the picture only up to 300 for the value of lowercase n. And you can guess that we cannot be happy forever. Here is the total picture, and we see that these levels somehow stop when they touch such a mysterious curve. And I have no explanation why it happens. And for a long time, it was a mystery for me what this curve should be. After some very vague heuristic considerations, I came to a guess that if we normalize our pictures by dividing the scale here by n and these values by n also, that the pictures would approach a limiting picture and this curve should be given by such a strange formula. But again, this is a mere guess and I have no proof and no ideas how to prove it. So this is again the same picture, and we see that points lie almost on horizontal lines, but you can guess that in fact these are not exactly equal values, and we can have a closer look, say, for this row. And to this end, I would subtract not one, but the first number, again take the logarithm, and here is the picture. How does it look? It looks similar to previous one, but there is a difference. Okay, here we're gonna have all even numbers, but now here we have numbers divisible by 5, but not divisible by 2. And on the next level, we have numbers divisible by 7, but not divisible neither by 2 nor by 5. And only on the next level, we have numbers divisible by 3, but not divisible neither by 2, nor by 5, nor by 7. Okay, then divisibility of 11, 13, and so on. So we could say that this is again a kind of a sieve of Eratosthenes, but with a bit different order of primes. 2, 5, 7, 3, 11, 13 and so on. Is this order natural or strange? Here we took every third number. So divisibility of m by 3 means that this index is divisible by 9. So this is a proper place for numbers divisible by 3. And of course, you can guess that these are not ideally equal numbers. We can repeat this construction, and it would split into sublevels further. And I made a guess how all this fractal structure is organized. If n range over progression in D is of this form, then the corresponding sublevels split according to the divisibility of the index m by p1, p2, and so on, where these prime numbers are ordered in such a way that their powers go in increasing order. In the previous example, m was equal to 3, so k3 was 1, others were zeros, and this was the order in which prime numbers were ordered: 1, 2, 5, 7, 3, 11, and so on. I wish you to show another sieve. Let us consider a plot of such quantities with just some initial deltas. And the plot looks like this. It's quite different. Here we have all odd numbers. Here, even numbers not divisible by 3. Here, numbers divisible by 6, but not divisible by 12. Here, numbers divisible by 12, but not divisible by 60. Here, numbers divisible by 60. But if we continue, it goes up to 420, which is divisible by 7, and this point drops below. If we continue, we will see that, again, if we reach the factor of 8, the next point drops lower. We can formally describe, again, this continues up to some mysterious curve. In order to formally describe this sieve, I introduce the notion of inheritable divisor. K is an inheritable divisor if it divides M, and all previous numbers also divides M. And of course, we can find the maximal inheritable divisor. It is a number that is an inheritable divisor, but the next number does not divide M any longer. And the splitting of numbers to the levels here is according to the maximal inheritable divisor. Why do I call this picture dual sieve? Let us look at classical sieve. We have multi-level sieve. Here numbers, every second number, every third, every fourth, and so on. And as soon as we remove the red tape, our numbers fell down. And we have here all even numbers, all odd numbers divisible by 3, nothing here, and so on. And this corresponds to considering these quantities. But we can fill the gaps here by green intervals and remove the blue intervals. And then we remove the red tape, and our numbers distribute on the levels according to their maximal inheritable divisor. And this corresponds to considering such sums. Besides zeta function, there is a large class of similar functions for which people believe that they satisfy a counterpart of the Riemann hypothesis. And there is a list of properties which we should expect from these functions. And one of these properties is so-called the functional equation found by Riemann. And it is considered to be a necessary ingredient for a function to satisfy counterpart of Riemann's hypothesis. If it doesn't satisfy, we cannot hope. But so far, we haven't used the functional equation in any way. This equation is stated in terms of this function xi of s. This is just a multiple of zeta of s, and this is the factor. Here we have three factors. This factor cancels the pole of the zeta function. The poles of the gamma function cancel the trivial zero of the zeta function. So the zeros of xi function are exactly the non-trivial zeros of the zeta function. And this exponential factor does not influence neither zeros nor poles, but it allows to write such a nice identity, which is called the functional equation. How could we incorporate the functional equation in our scheme? Could we demand, for example, that such equality should take place? Hardly. But finally, I found the way how to use the functional equation. What we need to do? We need somehow to forget about the trivial zeros. Zeta function, eta function, and xi functions have the same complex zeros. So how we can get a different behavior for determinants? We can do the following. This is our xi function. It is this multiple. And we can just put this factor inside summation sign. But then we can use the functional equation and get another sum. And we can just add these two sums and obtain such a summation. And I will denote just the summand fn of s. And it's clear to see that this summand satisfies a counterpart of the functional equation. So formally, it is symmetrical. It looks as we got the functional equations just for nothing. But in fact, there is a great cheating here, because this series converges only when the real part of S is greater than 1. This series converges only when the real part of S is below 0. So where does this series converge? So this is just very formal equality. But nevertheless, it allows us to construct new determinants. I will define them in the following way. Again, we have columns corresponding to zeta zeros. No longer we need to consider zeros and their conjugate, because we have now this nice equation. And as soon as a number is zero, its conjugate is automatically zero. And instead of previous n to minus 0, I use just these summands everywhere. Again, formally, we can expand it according to the last column and obtain formally such a sum, make normalization. And now we can consider these deltas with upper index gamma. Please pay attention that this sum is not normalization of this sum. I want to have here a genuine Dirichlet series, so I drop this factor. Here it's just deltas. I drop this factor. I use just n to minus s. And the normalization would look like this. And it turns out that these new deltas with upper index gamma have many properties similar to previous case, but there are some new interesting properties as well. First of all, these determinants need not vanish when S is equal to these zeros, because here we use different summons. Nevertheless, they vanish very close to the original zeros used for its construction, and also they vanish a bit further as before. And this was standard C for Vitasfinos for deltas without gamma. With gamma, they look a bit different and a bit less impressive. But now we can do the following. We have our finite sums. They look like this alternative sum, which is the product of this factor and zeta function. We can formally divide the left-hand side by zeta of S. This is just divide an finite Dirichlet series by infinite Dirichlet series and obtain some infinite Dirichlet series. And we should expect this to be something equal to, approximately equal to this Dirichlet series, that is, the first coefficient is equal, approximately equal to 1, second equal to approximately to minus 2, and others should be very, very small quantities. These numbers can be defined directly via a Möbius summation. And here is how these numbers look. In fact, they very quickly became very small numbers, but then they distribute on two levels initially. But again, this happened until some point when they all lie on the same curve. And we can have a close look at these two levels. We see that on one level, all these deltas are of the same sign, which is called magenta. And these numbers on this level are prime and prime numbers. So again, in this strange way, we discover prime numbers from zeta zeros. So zeta zeros encodes prime numbers in yet another way. If I look just in the neighborhood of these points, we will see a more interesting picture. Here we have just primes, here squares of primes, cubes of primes, and so on. So it looks like a logarithmic function, and it's natural to divide by log of n here. And then, in fact, all these points go to the horizontal lines. And this level is half of this one, so it's more natural to divide not by log of n, but by von Mangold function, which is defined in this way, just log of p for any power of p. And then all points do lie on the same horizontal line. And I will denote this ratio omega with the value of the capital N. This is a very small number. And in fact, all these numbers are very close whenever p is a prime. And now I would like to modify this picture a bit. So here we have something very well organized, primes and prime powers, but initially we have some different values. I want to remove initial points and put extra points on this level. So I remove 11 initial points and add 11 points here. Formally, I add to this ratio this finite sum. This will cancel initial points here, and this will add black points here. And so in our annotation, this looks like such a sum where we have here von Mangold function. And this sum is well known, it is just the negation of logarithmic derivative of zeta function. And so this happens only at some initial fragment. After that, the coefficients in this sum in this ratio began to grow very quickly, but the coefficients here remain very small because of this factor. The question whether this expression could be numerically close to this ratio. At first it looks very unlikely, but nevertheless it turned out to be the case. So we can here multiply by denominator and to guess that such approximate equality should take place. We can first verify it when S is equal to a zero of zeta, then this summit would diminish, and we can guess that these deltas should be approximately equal to this values of the derivative. And indeed, here is the table of values. We see that, in fact, this ratio is very close to minus one. We can get a lot of correct values of the delta of zeta derivative at its zeros. And if you want to make calculations at other points, not zeros, we need to use this finite correction term. And then we can get correct values of the derivative inside the critical line and even to the left of the critical strip. And even very much to the left of the critical strip, we will see can get a very good approximation to the zeta derivative. There is one shortcoming of this formula because here we need to know the value of zeta itself and to know it with great accuracy because here there is a great cancellation. But we could avoid it in the following way. We can use two values for capital N and capital N1 and capital N2 and to write such a system of two approximate equalities to treat zeta of S and its derivative as unknowns, solve the system, and to get in one calculation very good approximations to the value of zeta of S and not so good approximations to its derivative in a very large area, again, much to the left of the critical line. If you don't like to use calculations with two different values of capital N, you can do the following. You can write this approximate equality. You can use the functional equation and write a dual approximate equation. You can write the functional equation itself, and you can differentiate it and treat it as a system of four linear equations with four unknowns, zeta of S, zeta of 1 minus S, and its derivative at these points. And solving this system, we get very correct values of all these four quantities. So these are some of the discoveries which were made with very intensive computations. I don't have time to tell about other things, but I put my discoveries on this site. You are welcome to visit it and see if there will be new development. And also, if I would be happy if you would continue this line of research and get some interesting, at least observations. I don't say about proofs. Proofs would be great. And then I would be happy to put your discoveries to this site also. Thank you very much for attention.
Thank you for a very intriguing talk. Are there any questions?
Looking at your plots of the coefficients delta n, it seems to me that what you're computing is some approximate functional equation for the zeta function. So there's a whole class of series expansion for the zeta where you truncate the Dirichlet series and you cut off in a smooth way.
Yes.
And so in your situation, you're using, I don't know, like, Dirichlet series of lengths, a few thousand to get the first few thousand zeros, and then you get maybe, I don't know, it wasn't clear from your talk, how many more zeros do you get? Is it maybe double? If you take 1,000 turns, then how many zeros, if you input 1,000 zeros, how many zeros do you expect to output?
Maybe several thousand. I did not make exact calculations. I can say the following. Of course, we can use approximate functional equation, and we need to weigh how to smooth it, which is important, and how this smoothing comes in a natural way. And if you use your own way to make it smooth, I never thought that you would discover primes in this way. And here we have something natural and recover prime numbers in this way. So this seems interesting.
So you're seeing the primes at the level of these secondary terms, meaning that once you subtract one and you're seeing it at the very low, 10 to the minus 500 or something is where you're...
Yes.
They're not entering in a crucial way for the computation, it's just a phenomenon.
No. Of course, it's not a way to compute anything. It's just a way to think about why it is so. I do not propose it as a tool.
Are there any other questions? Well, I had some sort of a meta question. So what is sort of most exciting for you as the next steps? To do some more computational experiments to see what's happening or trying to find some proofs for some of these functions of the equations, of the functions that you found, find the formula for them?
On the one hand, there are many other directions to make computations. For example, to make computations for other Dirichlet series like L functions, and more was done, in fact. We can do more strange things. We can say that we know exactly some coefficients, for example. And so there are many ways to do further computations. And for example, it was just a guess about this fractal structure, but we need more numerical evidence to in its support. I took time out to think about it. So for a long time, I do not do any further computations. I try to get some understanding of it. And in fact, this is a rather time-consuming computations. Because this effect appears only for large matrices. And I began to compute it with my personal computer and ended with using supercomputer in Moscow. And also my colleague, Gleb Belyakin from Australia, used supercomputer in Australia. So it's many hours on supercomputers. It's rather time consuming. So yes.
Another question about what sort of precision is needed when you compute the coefficients with the determinants relative to the final precision that you desire.
Finally, we have computed 40,000 zeros with 40,000 digits, and. But I would not say that all these zeros, all this precision was used because it takes a long time to compute. And so.
So if you input 40,000 digits precision, how many digits precision do you get out?
We made a plot how the precision goes down, and it's almost linear, but I don't remember the figures. You can see it in the paper. Of course,
Another
Do you expect the same sort of behavior with things like calcium?
I never tried to calculate anything else. So first of all, we need to a way to calculate zeros with great precision. And actually, this was made possible only because of a system named ARP by Fredrik Johansson, and who implemented very efficient way to calculate zeta zeros. For all the functions, we will need at first find how to calculate the zeros with this precision.
Thank you. Are there any other questions? If not, I'd like to thank the speaker once again.